us. Good morning and happy Sabbath. It is good to see you guys yet again on another beautiful, amazing, sunshiny Sabbath morning. Cold weather is coming, my friends. We felt a tinge of it this morning, but it's still warm outside, decently warm. So I'm glad, I'm happy. I want to welcome you guys here on this beautiful Sabbath day. Glad you guys are here joining us as we dive again into God's Word and discover more beautiful, precious promises. I am really looking forward to the presentation by Pastor Phil this morning, where we're going to be looking into heaven and what it is. And I'm really looking forward to that. I just have a couple of quick announcements for us today. I want to remind you about the fellowship dinner that we are going to be having in the gym just after the meeting today. Visitors, we want you to know that you are welcomed. In fact, I want you to stand up, I want you to turn to your neighbor, and I want you to greet your neighbor. Welcome them and say, "Happy Sabbath, we're so glad you're here." So stand up and welcome your neighbor. Alrighty. Thank you, guys. You know, it's amazing to be part of a big and joyous family that comes together on God's beautiful Sabbath day to worship Him. I want to move forward. I want to, those of you that came in, you received a paper, at least I hope most of you did, that advertises a Whole Foods cooking school that's happening tomorrow. When is it happening? Tomorrow at 5 p.m. downstairs in the fellowship hall, we're going to be having a Whole Foods cooking school. You're not going to want to miss this. The presenter loves to cook, and the presenter loves to share tips how to cook. I know from experience. So you're not going to want to miss it. Other than that, again, remember the Bible school? We have the question box out there. Put your questions in. We're going to be wrapping up Jesus on Prophecy very soon. After this morning's presentation, I want to invite you guys again to join us tonight at 7 o'clock for our second to last presentation. Then Monday night, when? Monday night is our last presentation for Jesus on Prophecy. Just because it's the last meeting doesn't mean that you can miss it. You guys are all welcome. We would love to see you there. Then we start on Wednesday night, we start phase two, and I am super excited about phase two. We're going to be meeting down in the fellowship hall. We're going to have a light meal, and we're going to have an awesome Bible study. We're going to be going back over some of the topics that we've covered in Jesus on Prophecy. You're not going to want to miss it. Wednesday night at 6 o'clock.
If you don't mind, Pastor Jericho, I just want to make sure everyone understands what's happening with phase two. Happy Sabbath, everybody. Good to see you all. Now, Pastor Jericho is helping coordinate phase two. Now, Pastor Jericho, how often during the week is phase two happening?
Once a week.
Once a week. Once a week. What time does it start?
6 o'clock.
But Pastor Jericho, what am I going to do if I haven't had supper trying to make it back from work?
Well, we are going to be providing a light meal.
So a light meal, and I also, how many classes are we doing every Wednesday evening?
So we're actually going to be doing two classes. We're doing back-to-back 45-minute sessions each with a small break in between.
With a supper in between. And then what book are we studying?
We're going to be going over the book of Daniel chapter by chapter. We're going to be unlocking Daniel's mysteries.
How many of you have wondered what Daniel means? At some point, I see a lot of hands going up. This Wednesday evening, chapter by chapter, starting in chapter 1, all the way through chapter 11, which is like calculus, and then chapter 12. You don't want to miss it. Don't let the word calculus scare you. I love math, so to me that gets me excited. But if it doesn't for you, that's okay. You'll love it. I know the Lord's going to bless.
And I'm really looking forward to it. So for the next 6 weeks, every Wednesday, once a week, just on Wednesday, every Wednesday for the next 6 weeks, from 6 o'clock to 8 o'clock, you're not going to want to miss it. It's going to be amazing. This time I want to invite Miss Lindsay.
All right. Well, only a few more health talks left before our meetings are over. But today's is a very serious topic that many of us, if not all of us, have had some experience with, and that is life after loss. How to grow out of our grief. And in this session, we're asking that question, how do we move forward with life after a loss? It's difficult to make sense of many terrible losses, whether it's death, injury, health, property, friends, or a job. And loss has many faces that touch every life. Someone once said, God marks across some of our days, saying, I will explain that later. So we don't always understand as we're going through it, but God marks, one day I'll explain that to you. So is there a way to navigate the storms of life and develop an attitude of security, strength, and even serenity? John Claypool was a young pastor when he lost his 8-year-old daughter in a tragic 2-year battle with leukemia. And he wrote a book called Tracks of a Fellow Struggler. He describes his daughter's sickness and death as the most wounding but enlightening experience of his life. And he shares how he learned deep lessons of trust and faith during this journey. The promise that meant so much to him in caring for his sick daughter was this one in Isaiah chapter 40. It says, those who wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. So I had to look at this several times to catch what he got out of it. But he discovered actually 3 promises of God's presence in a believer's life. The first promise is those who wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. Now, in this part, in mounting up with wings as eagles, we see the experience of exuberance and freedom. But this type of strength doesn't really fit the long nights of anxious care when tending a sick child. So we look at the second part of the promise, they shall run and not be weary. Here is the strength for action to solve problems and perform tasks. We have a busy life, but God sustains us. But in some situations, there's nothing that we can actually do. And then he got to the third part of the promise, walk and not faint. Now this might sound insignificant. Who wants to be slowed to a walk, creeping along inch by inch, just barely able to endure? This was not a time of exuberance, freedom, or busy activity for this pastor, John Claypool. This was his time to walk and not faint. In Claypool's words, he said, this is the only form of the promise that fits this situation. In the dark stretches of life, when you cannot soar and there is no place to run, to know of a help that will provide the strength that enables you to walk and not faint is good news indeed. To have the strength to take the next step, to hope, to endure, and to know that there is light at the end of the tunnel. This is power indeed. And God promises that an end to sorrow is coming. He says, God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death. Neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. Revelation 21:4. So the day will come for all of us who have experienced loss. The day will come when we can remember our loss without overwhelming pain. Healing takes place over time. And that's not to say that one day it won't be easier and you think you're getting over it, and a week later you feel like you're back to square one. But God still works to make good come out of bad situations. Things like faith, patience, forgiveness, gentleness, compassion, ministry, strength, courage, hope, optimism, and selflessness are all like little tender plants that can come out of the ashes of loss and pain. It is through the valley of suffering that the ministry of consolation is born in our hearts. Now, in 2 Corinthians, if you just read that first chapter, it's wonderful going through loss because it talks about this. It talks about how after experiencing loss or after needing comfort ourselves, God gives us opportunities to comfort others with the comfort that He's given us. And it's also important to take care of ourselves during these times of grief. Physical and spiritual nurture is vital during times of stress. Accept help from others and ask for it if you need it. The habits that we form in times of peace are the habits that we take with us into times of trial. So remember, even if it's not difficult now, making daily decisions that form the habits in times of peace prepare us for when we will experience difficulties. Take care of your health during times of loss. Take time for fresh air, exercise, and mental, physical, and emotional rest. Fill up on fresh fruits and vegetables for energy instead of candy and caffeine. We've looked a lot at this over the meetings. But it is those daily choices that we make all the time that will carry us through when we need to operate on autopilot. Loss can also make us grateful for what we have. It can make us more sensitive and more trusting. Now, there's a grief counselor, Larry Yeagley, who offers a plan for recovery in his book, Grief Recovery, and he calls it CPR. So that's really easy to remember, because when you're going through a crisis, just remember how to do CPR. Communicate is the C. Communicate your needs with someone you trust. Participate. Expand your activities in your social circles, and relationship, fostering relationships by giving and receiving. So CPR, communicate, participate, and relationships. Those are three vital components to surviving and thriving after a loss. Beyond the shock, grief, and anger of loss, there is hope, help, meaning, and most importantly, the promise of eternal life. And a promise for us today is in Matthew 11:28, come to me, all you who are troubled and weighted down with care, and I will give you rest. So trusting in God brings growth and strength. He'll comfort us and lead us through the trials in our life, and we can look forward to a new life in heaven when Jesus returns. But for now, in the here and now, we can say, I will put my life, my mind, my habits, and my world into God's hands, because God knows the way, and He will show us the way. Amen. God promises to do that for us.
Thanks, Sister Lindsay. We appreciate that. Amen. Our local offering today is for our church budget. And many of you know, obviously, that goes for towards the lights and the heat and all of the necessities that go on that we have to have for the church here. But really, at the end of the day, the offering that we give really goes out for evangelism and really being able to fund what needs to be done, not only inside the church, but more importantly, outside of the church. And, you know, when we do our honest part in making that happen, when we give, then we can fund all of the different outreach programs that we have going on in the church here, which have been obviously a huge blessing in one respect or another. So I just don't want you to think just, you know, hey, it's for the lights, it's for the heat, and it's for all those things, and the maintenance of the church, which it is, amen, because this is the Lord's house and we got to take care of it. But also we need to take care of those ministries outside of this church that need funding as well. And so we just need to make sure we think about that when we're giving in our offering. Amen. Let us pray. Father in heaven, Lord, we thank you in the name of Jesus for our local combined church budget, Lord, which again goes to the inward needs of your church. But Lord, we know you are the true mathematician, and you get excited about math just as much as our dear pastor does as well. And Lord, we know that you have a way of adding and subtracting and multiplying and dividing these funds that we give, that they may go to the work that you have called them to go towards. So we just pray, Lord, for each and everyone who is able to give today. And Lord, we pray for those who may not be in a position this day to give, but Lord, we pray that you indeed put them in a position that they would be able to go out and make ends meet and be able to give back that which you have given unto us. Be with this offering now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
To have happen today is God's love to shine over us. What do you say? Amen. Well, good morning and happy Sabbath. Lindsay and I are thankful to be back. This last week we're shooting Light Unshackled, and unfortunately the weather and the changing of the leaves in the New England area doesn't cooperate ideally with the timing of our meetings. But God was good. Pastor Jericho was able to carry on. God worked some miracles while we were in New England with the shooting. The footage turned out amazing. And the story that we were shooting this time is two men that started at the same place as agnostics: William Miller and Charles Darwin. We were shooting the aspect of William Miller's story. So we were at the Battle of Plattsburgh, we were at his farm, and we were shooting different aspects of that story. Next spring, we'll be going to England to shoot Charles Darwin, and in February, we're going to the Galapagos Island to shoot that aspect of the story of Charles Darwin. Darwin turned to nature to answer the questions of whether God existed and came out an evolutionist. Miller turned to the Bible and came out with an incredible message out of Daniel chapter 8 and verse 14. Does it matter where we go for our source of authority? It absolutely does. What you make as where you focus will make all the difference as to where you end up. It's interesting, Charles Darwin was headed into being a clergyman. And he came out as, he didn't come up with the theory of evolution, by the way. His grandfather had started laying the foundations. But he put together the story that sold it to the masses. We want to make the Bible our foundation. So anyway, it's good to be back with you all. We're glad to be here. I am, you know, wherever I'm gone, I'm reminded how much I love this church family and how good it is to be back with each one of you. If you're visiting today, we want you to feel very welcomed, and we're so glad that you're here, and I hope that you can stay for the meal afterwards. But would you bow your heads with me as we ask the Lord to be with us this morning? Gracious Heavenly Father, as we kneel before you here, how thankful we are that in every situation we find ourselves in, as we turn to you, you provide the needs that our hearts long for. Father, it may not be the wants that we have, But you always give us the needs. And if we could see what you would see, we would see that you are also giving us what we should want, even though we may not have thought we needed that. So thankful for how much you care for us. As we gather here to worship you, and as we move into this sacred time of studying your word, Father, we ask that you will speak to our hearts and that you will guide our minds. Banish Satan and his angels from having access to this sanctuary. Carry us up to heaven to see the love of Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen. Prophecy's final destination. Where are we headed and how is it going to be once we get there? Have you ever wondered what heaven is going to be like? I sat down on my computer. I love to design and lay out buildings and design structures. So I decided to sit down and lay out what heaven looked like at one point. And when I put the whole structure together, I was shocked at the scale of what heaven is. The question is heaven real? Is it something we are looking forward to? Or is it something that's just going to kind of maybe, maybe not? If you go around and you ask a bunch of people whether heaven is real, you'll probably come across questions or answers like this. Heaven, man, that's pie in the sky. Out there somewhere, unreal, man. I can't fathom it. That might be one answer. Or another person, I've run across this a number of times. Heaven is a what? State of mind. It's an inner peace. It's a state of calm. There isn't a place called heaven. Heaven is whatever you choose to make it. If you feel happy and satisfied, well, then you're in your own type of heaven. Yeah. This one person said this, a very wealthy businessman said, heaven is my house. It's worth $3 million. My chariot is my Jaguar, and the angels are my kids. And then they became teenagers. No, I was a teenager at one point, too. I was obviously an angel. Let's move on. Heaven is, oh, you're so out of touch that you still believe in those fairy tales. A lot of people have different perspectives of heaven is. An older couple might say, we hope heaven is a real place. The older we get, the more we long for it. We just hope that what we're taught in our childhood is true. Do you hope that heaven is real this morning? I want to assure you that God's word tells us that heaven is real. And it's not just talking about some mystical spiritual experience. Heaven is a physical, tangible location that we someday are going to go to. What is heaven really like? What does it look like? How does it come together? Hold your Bibles up. We're about to go into the Word. We're going to do it a little different than Pastor Jericho has been doing it, but you've also seen this slide a few times. Holding your Bibles up, read it aloud with me. If it's in the Bible, I believe it. If it disagrees with the Bible, it's not for me. If it's here, we're going to take it. And what we find in the Bible about heaven is incredible. Go with me to Revelation chapter 21 and verse 1 as we begin to unpack what the beauty of heaven is like. I can't wait to go. I want to be there so bad. I want to see Jesus again. I want his love to take control of my life. Revelation chapter 21 and verse 1, are you there? Notice what it says. Now I saw a what? A new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and also there was no more what? Sea. John the Revelator there on the Isle of Patmos in November. My wife and I with our film crew are going to be on Patmos. I've never been there before. I look forward to being there. But when John was on Patmos, he was there as a prisoner. It was a prison island. He was there for the faith that he had in Jesus Christ. Can you hear me? Ooh, it's back. You know, Satan doesn't like heaven being talked about because he doesn't want any of us to get there. Are you with me? But thankfully, when you replace the battery, it'll work and his plans will be thwarted by the grace of God. Talking about heaven. Heaven is, Let me just go back to here. John's there on the Isle of Patmos. He's there as a prisoner for his faith in Jesus Christ. He's in his late 80s or early 90s. He's an old man, white hair, white beard. He is no longer able to move around as easily as he could before. But as he is there, and as he's there, God gives him a vision of what heaven is going to be like, a vision of what the future is going to be like. And as God comes down to the end of this vision that he's given his aged apostle, the one Jesus loved, God gives him a view of heaven. And I can see John the Revelator as he's looking there. Thank you, Pastor Jericho. Thank you, Brother Jason. Let's see if we're back on.
Can you hear me?
Nope. I don't think it's working yet. It's okay. I can just use the handheld. Let me try one more time. I know it's popping a lot. I feel like I'm back on the film trip, and we're fighting technology. Okay. Let's move over to the blue. There we are. Is that better? Okay, now you won't have the popping, and we'll be able to continue on going through the Word. Are you still with me? Let's keep going. He's there. We're going to eventually get off the Isle of Patmos. He's there on the Isle of Patmos, and God gives him a vision of heaven. And one of the things that stands out to John is there's not going to be any more sea. As he looks out off that view of the island, and he sees the water between him and his family and his loved ones and the people, his church family, I can see a tear trickling down his cheek as he thanks the Lord that someday there's not going to be any more sea. John is one in a long line of prophets and patriarchs who are looking forward to the second coming. Not just the second coming, but looking forward to when God was going to write everything. Each of the prophets from Genesis to Revelation pointed men and women forward to what? New heavens and a new earth. It's going to be Eden restored. To understand what Eden restored is like, I want you in your imaginations and allow your imagination to really try, we can't fully, but really try to picture what it's like. Go back with me to the original Eden. As the earth came forth from the hand of the Creator, it was stunning in every particular. I love streams. I love waterfalls. I love looking down when it's crystal clear and seeing the gorgeous fish swimming through the water and watching the sun reflect off of their scales with all kinds of different colors. In heaven, there are many crystal streams. And in Eden, at the beginning, across our planet, were these beautiful water features. I can imagine it in my mind. Lush vegetation on every area. Fruits to greet you on all of the different trees. Those wonderful mangoes, the delicious fresh dates, the amazing grapes and the apples and many fruits we probably don't even know about were there, and the smell of the flowers just wafted over the landscape. Animals of every shape and variety, and there was no fear. You saw a lion, you didn't turn around and book it. You went up and petted the huge lion and told her, "Here, good kitty." It's a completely different than what we have today. This is how God intended our earth to be. Perfect, beautiful, lovely on every area of the world. And there was love and joy and companionship. Not only were the animals getting along, there weren't mosquitoes, praise God. Especially in Michigan, there were no mosquitoes. That is going to come and be eradicated in the end. I hate mosquitoes. They're going to be gone. And they weren't in the original. There weren't stinging bees. I got stung on this last trip on my right shoulder. There won't be stinging bees anymore. There will be love, joy, and companionship everywhere. But into this beauty, an intruder came. You remember the story. Eve's walking through the garden, and she comes to the base of the tree of knowledge of good and evil. What had God told Adam and Eve they were not to do? They were not to eat. And he said, "In the day of you eat of it, you shall surely what? Die." And Eve's standing there, and she sees this dazzling serpent. Beautiful, reflective in the sun. I believe that the serpent was beautiful. And that the reason why God cursed it onto its belly is that it was able to fly before it was used by Satan. It was one of the brightest before the curse of God in Genesis chapter 3. And this animal begins to talk to her, and Eve is allured by the animal talking. And she comes and she takes of the fruit and she eats. And as she eats of that fruit, ushered into our planet was the brokenness that we see today. The sad drama of sin all originated in Eden at the fall when we ate of the fruit. Adam and Eve were first introduced to it by the animal being slain for their clothes and for the sacrifice system that God established. They then was brought very close to home when one of their own children, Cain, slew his brother Abel, and they realized that sin doesn't just hurt the environment. Sin hurts the people we love. Sin is the origination of everything that's wrong in our planet. As the drama of sin unfolded, Adam, for hundreds and hundreds of years, watched as his children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren, great-great-grandchildren, all the way down for 800-900 years, became more and more corrupt and despotic and broken. But all the way through here, God had a royal line of people who were faithful. There was Adam, who was faithful. There was Noah, who was faithful. There were these men and women who said, though the rest of the world walks away from God, we are going to remain faithful. Because this world is not our home. Abraham, there in Ur of the Chaldees, as he's there in a culture that was actually quite advanced, from what we can tell, they had running water, they had plumbing. That's incredible. It was a nice place to live. And God says, I want you to leave. I want you to go to a place that I'm going to show you. And I want to tell you this right here. If God says go, no matter how comfortable it might be, we should go. Abraham could absolutely understand what many of us would feel when God has come in and he said, Phil, I need you to leave the comfort of where you are, and I want you to go. And I go, God, I really like where I am. I love the people that I know here. I love the environment. I love the friendships that I have. And God says, no, put all that aside. I'm calling you to go. Abraham understood that call. And when God put his finger on Abraham and he said, Abraham, it's time to go, Abraham went. And I want you to notice what the Bible says here. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 10. Take your Bibles and go with me to Hebrews chapter 11. I want you to notice what the Word of God says. Hebrews chapter 11, and when you're there, if you'd say amen. When Abraham left, he went with a very specific thing in mind. I hear some pages turning. We're almost there. Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 10. Are you there? Notice what it says. For he, Abraham, waited for this city which has foundations, whose builder and maker is who? Is this an earthly city? Is this an earthly city? No. The builder and maker of the city of the New Jerusalem is God himself. Abraham was looking forward to living in the city that God built. He wanted more than just plumbing and running water. He wanted streets of gold. Are you with me? He wanted more than just the passing luxuries of this earth. He wanted an eternity that never ended. Moses looked forward to the city of God. Here he is, raised in royalty, surrounded by every luxury and advantage of the Egyptian Empire, which was centuries ahead of the rest of the culture around them. We still don't fully understand how advanced the Egyptian culture was. And Moses was thrown into the middle of that. He had every luxury, advantage, and opportunity laid in front of him. He could have done whatever he wanted. And yet Moses walked away from it all because he was looking forward to heaven. Hebrews chapter 11, drop down with me to verses 24 through 26. Right there in that same chapter, I want you to notice what the Bible says. By faith, Moses, when he became what? of age, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God. Can you believe that? What did Joseph choose? He chose to suffer affliction with who? The people of God, rather than to enjoy the passing pleasures of sin. Why? Esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures in Egypt, for he looked what? To the, do you see it there? Where was Joseph looking? He wasn't looking to earthly luxury and pleasure. He wasn't looking for the right connections to get him higher up in the business world. Moses, who had his focus on the New Jerusalem. Where's your focus this morning? Are you struggling with wanting the latest job advancement? Are you trying to get to the next level? Are you worried about your friends around you or whether you have the right home or not or some other concern? I want to submit to you that the example of Moses, the example of Abraham is an example we can follow. Our eyes fixed towards the city that God has made for us. What do you say? Hebrews 11, verses 13 through 14, going back up just a few verses in the same chapter. I want you to notice what the Apostle Paul says here in verse 13. These all died in what? Faith, not having received the promise, but having seen them afar off, were assured of them, embraced them, and confessed that they were what? Strangers. And say it with me, pilgrims where? On this earth. Is this earth our home, yes or no? No. We are strangers because we have a heavenly home that God has gone to prepare for us. What do you say? We are in a long line of men and women who the world was not worthy of, who were persecuted for what they believed, who lost everything that was precious on this planet because they realized it was nothing compared to the eternity that God had for them. I mean, think about it with me. 70 years versus infinity, which is more valuable? Why would we choose the 70 over the infinite? I'll tell you what happens. We lose focus on Jesus. And Satan comes alongside us and he says, oh, this is so much more important. And he begins to jingle that rattle that we like at our age. You know, babies love rattles, and as adults, we go, oh, that's so cute. And then we get a little older, and the jingling of our keys becomes a rattle for a new car. And then we get a little older, and now it's a house, and that's still the same. All these things, not that they're not important. They're good things. Don't misunderstand me. But if they take the place of focusing on Jesus, we have a problem. Are you with me? We're to be strangers and pilgrims. Continuing on in verse 14. For those who say such things declare plainly that they seek a what? A homeland. This world is not our home. We are headed to a new homeland. Verse 16, but now they desire a better, that is a heavenly country, a place that God builds. Last part of the verse I love. Let this verse sink in. We're talking about people who are focused on a heavenly country. We're talking about people that aren't focused on being successful here on this planet. They're focused about being successful for Jesus. And notice what God says. Therefore, God is what? Not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared a city for them. Has God prepared a city for you? The Bible says it. If the Bible says it, we believe it. Heaven, the New Jerusalem is not some spiritual place. I did some research this last week in preparation for our sermon this morning. And what was amazing to me is how many different outlets I read talked about how the New Jerusalem is a spiritual experience and it's not a real place. But my Bible says it's real. What do you say? God has prepared a city for them. And it's so incredible, we can't even comprehend it. No matter how long we've spent studying this, we'll never fully grasp what heaven is like, but we can get some glimpses. But I want you to understand this. 1 Corinthians 2, verse 9, Paul says, but as it is written, eye has not seen, nor ear heard, nor have entered into the heart of man, the things which what? God has prepared for those who love him. You can't comprehend it. You can't imagine it. The best picture an artist can do doesn't come close. The greatest envisioning of what it is like won't do it justice. Plan to be there, amen? But let's look at what God does give us. In heaven, and I look forward to this because, as we announced last week, a baby's on its way. And I'm looking forward to being a father, and I covet your prayers. But the great hope that comes and the love that you experience as a parent looking over that precious child that's been born doesn't compare with the love and joy that God has for us in heaven. And that's hard to comprehend. The fellowship of the closest knit friendship circle doesn't compare with the fellowship of what we're going to have in heaven. Heaven's fellowship is closer. Heaven's love is deeper. Heaven's care is broader. We can't comprehend it. So let's go and look at this New Jerusalem. Let's see what the Bible tells us about our home. So go back with me to the book of Revelation, and we're going to spend some time here meditating through these verses and looking at what God tells us about the New Jerusalem. We're going to be in Revelation chapter 21 for the majority of our time as we study through what the New Jerusalem looks like. So if you are taking notes and you're wanting to follow along the notes here, just put a Revelation 21 heading and then heaven. We're going to have some other verses we're looking at, but I would encourage you to start making a bullet list of all the characteristics of what's going to be in heaven that you can write down so that you can review it later and be encouraged by the new heavens that God has for us. Let's start at Revelation chapter 21 and verse 2. Are you there? Notice what the Bible says. Then I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a what? A bride adorned for her husband. It is the New Jerusalem. I can picture it in my mind. This magnificent city beginning to make its way through space. Now for this to happen, there's a number of technological challenges that God, for him, is quite easy, obviously solves. One, God has to keep an atmosphere inside of the New Jerusalem. How he does it, I don't know. Maybe it's force fields. For another, God has to be able to move it through the universe. How he does it, I don't know. But somehow, God has all this technology. It isn't a magical event. It is an event that happens as powerful, and this city that's hundreds of miles in circumference and diameter makes its way towards this planet. And then it hits our atmosphere. Then it begins to come down. And can you picture what that would look like? It's coming down towards this planet. Wherever it lands, God's going to have to put a broad, flat plane that it comes down and lands upon. The city is coming. Now notice how big this city is. Let's go down to verse 14 of Revelation 21, and let's look at the size of this city and the foundations of this city. Now, the wall of the city had how many foundations? Why 12 foundations? How many apostles were there? How many tribes were there? 12. Why does this matter to God? Because God wants us to know each one of the 12. In fact, the foundations have the name of the 12 apostles are on it. You'll see that in the rest of the verse there. God wants us to understand that this is an inclusive place for everybody. Peter's name is there. What is remembered about Peter? One, he talked a lot. Two, he denied his Lord. Three, he confessed and Jesus forgave him. You might have messed up in your life. Heaven, if you come back to Jesus, heaven's for you. You have the sons of thunder. They were known for being rash and bold, trying to call fire down from God out of heaven on people who didn't accept Jesus. But God changed their hearts and they became the apostles of love. Today you might be someone who's known for being brash and bold. Under the influence of Jesus, you can be used in a mighty way for him, and heaven can be for you. You might be like Thomas, who struggled with wanting to know if everything, struggling to believe. He was known as Doubting Thomas. And you might struggle with doubt in your life. You might struggle with discouragement. You might struggle with depression in your life. But God wants you to know, Jesus wants you to know that his power can lift you up. He can strengthen you. He can recreate you. And heaven is for you. Each one of the apostles' names are written on the 12 foundations because God wants us to know that heaven is for every person, every personality, every person, no matter your background, whether you come from a wealthy or a poor, educated, uneducated, successful, not successful, whatever it is, in Jesus, heaven can be your home. Let's keep going. These followers of Christ were people with their faults, but their names are on the foundation of the holy city. Why? Because heaven is for everybody. God is saying to us, if they can make it, so can we. Revelation chapter 21 and verse 16. Let's look at the size of the New Jerusalem. The size is absolutely incredible. Notice verse 16. The city is laid out as a what? Square. So that means its length is the same as its. And the Bible says that. Its length is as great as its what? Its breadth. So it's this beautiful square. The city of heaven, if you were to look at it and we were to have it up here, which obviously we couldn't because it'd be far too big, would be this incredible square. And all the way around the city, Revelation tells us a little bit later, are 12 gates, three on each side. Now this is very unusual. In Bible times, cities had as few gates as possible because every place you had a gate, there was a weakness. But who's the one who's in charge of this city? It's God. They don't need walls to protect them. They have the King of the universe on their side. Why do we have 12 gates? Because God wants to make sure that every person knows no matter where you're coming from, you can come into this city. Whether you're coming from the north, the south, the east, or the west, or anywhere in between those main four directions, heaven has a gate for you. Praise God. Heaven's goal is to get as many people in as possible. Wherever you are, you can make it in through one of these gates by the grace of God. Everyone comes through the gates. Jesus said, I am the gate. We come in through the grace of Jesus Christ to be able to be there. Now notice the size of this city. Last part of verse 16. And he measured the city with a reed. 12,000 what? Furlong. Its length and breadth and height are equal. Now, how did they measure cities back then? When you were told the dimensions of a city, the city, they were measuring all the way around the entire wall because cities always weren't square. So you might have a wall that goes like this and like this and like this. So when you were given the measurement of a city, you were given the measurement of the circumference of the city. So the circumference of the New Jerusalem is 12,000 furlongs. What is that in miles? The circumference of the New Jerusalem, don't miss this, is 1,500 miles. Now, someone do the math, or don't, I'll do it for you. Divide 1,500 divided by 4, 375 miles on a side. 375 miles on a side. That's huge. That's the side of the New Jerusalem. I tried to put together a scale model. It didn't turn out very well, so I didn't put it on the screen. But I tried to put together a scale model of what this could have looked like. And when you begin to understand the sheer scale, it's incredible to comprehend. Now, it doesn't say, just say that its length and width are this, but it also says that the height is going to be the same. That's 375 miles up into the air. If I remember right, space starts, is it 80 miles or 50 miles? The space starts long before this. This goes over 200 plus miles into space. Heaven's big. Someone has asked, well, what is the shape of heaven? We know that the base is square. Some have thought it's a cube. I would submit The Bible doesn't tell us, so let me be clear, this is my thinking about it, but I have wondered if it looks more like a pyramid, and I'll tell you why. Because God's throne is the highest place in heaven. Are you with me? And we're told that the God's throne is in the center, that it's on a high mountain, high and lifted up, and it's going to be above everything else. And so if it's the highest and it's in the center, then everything else must come down from it all the way around. And I've wondered if some of the pyramids we've seen here are Satan's attempt to try to duplicate what God has. And of course, he always fails because Satan can't even come close to the beauty and the magnitude and the magnificence of God. You with me? Whatever it is, we know it's 375 miles high, and we know it's 375 miles wide, and its dimensions are huge. God's city is big. Let's talk about its gates. If you were to look at the gates of the New Jerusalem, you would see, we talked about how three are on a side. The Bible tells us that each gate is made with a pearl. Notice Revelation 21 and verse 21. The 12 gates were 12 what? Each individual gate was one pearl. That is a massive oyster. I don't know how you get, except we're talking about God and he can do anything. These are huge gates and they must look incredible there as these gems, almost like this white piece inside these golden walls that are stationed down each side. It is dazzling to look at heaven. Notice the streets of the city was pure gold, like transparent glass. God is so wealthy, he just puts it down on the pavement like it's nothing. You know, here we are scrambling for all we're worth to try to get a little money put aside, and God looks and he says, guys, I just put that down as my pavement. What are you doing? I can take care of you. Heaven is a promise that the God who paints his streets with gold can give you all the money that you could possibly need. It is our future home. It is a very real place, but it's also a promise that he can take care of us now. The incredible location of heaven, this magnificent city, the New Jerusalem, will soon make its way towards this planet. If you remember when we talked about how there's the millennium or the 1,000 years, and at the end of the 1,000 years, we've had the second coming, we've had the 1,000 years where Satan is bound to this planet, heaven, we, as God's people, are in heaven. At the end of the 1,000 years, the New Jerusalem makes its way through the universe towards our planet. And Satan, who's been bound on this planet, sees the New Jerusalem making its way here. And he knows that the final showdown is about to begin. And I can see, as he gets closer and closer, the dread growing more and more on his face. And then it begins to come down towards this planet. And Christ steps onto the Mount of Olives, and a mighty plain that's 375 miles on a side stretches out all around, and the city comes down. And it lands with far more grandeur than that noise. But I'm serious, it lands, and as it's there, God raises the wicked, the final showdown of the judgment. We've studied this already. The final showdown of the judgment takes place. Christ is high and lifted up at the top on his throne. The wicked realize that they've messed it up. They've lost. Fire comes down. The whole earth becomes a molten mass. And then sin and sinners are destroyed, and God creates a new heavens and a new earth. And the city of God no longer is the government of the universe somewhere else. God brings the government of the universe to the one planet that turned their back on him. What an incredible God. The planet he redeemed, the planet that above all others should have been the last in line. God says the first shall be last, and the last shall be what? First. And the rest of the universe, because they mirror the love of Jesus Christ and the compassion of Christ are ecstatic at a God who would come and move the center of the universe to the place of rebellion and say, this is the place where my government is going to be stationed. This is the place where the greatest love is going to be seen, because I restore completely that which was broken. As the earth comes forth from the hand of the Creator during that second creation, it is truly an Eden restored. As it was in Eden before, so it becomes an Eden restored. The world is bursting with flavors, colors, and every dimension and variety you can imagine. No longer is the lion trying to kill. Now it is compassionate. I want a pet cheetah in heaven. And it will be a wonderful pet to have. Animals that we haven't seen because they were destroyed by sin will repopulate this planet. Some of the dinosaurs that, from an evolutionary perspective, are made out to be these horrendous beings, we'll find out are majestic, beautiful creations of God that are far bigger than we can comprehend, but are also beautiful animals. Isaiah 35 and verse 1, describing this scene, says, "The wilderness and the wasteland shall be glad for them, and the desert shall rejoice and blossom as the rose. The places of desolation will be restored." There won't be a desert in the new earth. There will not be places where you look at and you go, well, I just don't want to visit that area because it's just really flat and ugly. It's all beautiful. Straight from the hand of the Creator, the beauty of Eden will be restored. There will be the hills full of flowers, the streams that are running through, the beautiful fish there. What will our physical condition be like in the new earth? Many have wondered, what are we going to look like in heaven? Well, let's just take a little bit of time to look at what the Bible tells us. Philippians chapter 3. Go with me to Philippians chapter 3. And let's notice verses 20 and 21, what the Bible says about what it'll be like for our bodies in heaven. Philippians chapter 3, verses 20 and 21. Are you there? Notice what the Bible says. "For our citizenship is in" where? "From which we also eagerly wait for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will" what? "Transform our lowly body that may be conformed to" his what? "Glorious body." Two things I want to point out. First, we are transformed like Jesus was transformed. And if we want to understand what our transformation will be like, we need to look at what his transformation was like. You know, someone asked me some years ago, you know, when we get to heaven and we go through this transformation, second point I wanted to bring out, when we go through this transformation, won't it be very painful? And my response is very simple. I think the God who knows how to raise the dead also knows how to make sure that it doesn't hurt. Are you with me? "Transform our lowly bodies so that they may be conformed to his glorious body." Let's look at what happened to Christ's glorious, resurrected, immortal body. What was it like when Christ came out of the tomb? The Bible clearly says it will be like him. There are a number of examples where we can glean some truths of what our glorious body will be like. When Christ was walking along with the disciples on the road to Emmaus, he was talking to them. You'll find this story, I believe it's in Luke chapter 24. You'll find that as they were walking down this road, the disciples initially didn't recognize him. They were on either side of him. They were discussing. They were so broken over everything that had happened in Jerusalem. They didn't initially recognize him. But I want you to notice how they did recognize him. It was at supper that evening, as they were gathering around, and the food was laid out, this simple fare from simple men. And Jesus, who doesn't need fancy places to eat, he just wants to be with his people, raises his hands to bless. And Jesus must have a unique mannerism of how he blesses. Every one of us have our unique mannerisms, don't we? And some people, we recognize people sometimes from a distance. Even if we can't see their face, we can recognize them. Hey, they're walking like so-and-so. They're talking like so-and-so. Their hands are moving like so-and-so. But that unique mannerism, in heaven we'll have those. And as Jesus in his glorified body did the unique mannerism, the disciples recognized him. And they knew that it was Jesus. In heaven, though the scars we've had here on planet Earth will be gone, though the diseases that we've struggled with will be gone, we'll have our perfect, beautiful, glorious bodies, we'll still have our mannerisms. We'll still have the same similar things that we were here, because though we are in an immortal body, we're in the same people that we were. Let me explain what I mean. Jesus, here on this earth, is reproducing the character of himself inside us. We don't become a different person in heaven. We just don't have a tempter tempting us anymore. The character for heaven we develop today. We find the story of Mary there when Christ, just after the resurrection of Christ, before he descended to his Father. Mary had come to see the tomb of Jesus and to anoint his body. It was early, early Sunday morning. She gets there, and he's not there. And the anguish of her heart, the tears start just coursing down her cheeks, the sobs rack her body. And then she sees a man, and she doesn't recognize him because of the tears in her eyes, and she isn't able to see him, and he's in a glorified body now, and she's not even thinking that Jesus is resurrected. But then Jesus says, "Mary." And she recognizes him by his voice. We will be recognized not just by our mannerisms, but also by our voice as we speak. The last thing is, there are some dimensions of our physical form that will be recognized as well. When Jesus appeared to the disciples in the upper room, they recognized him by his form as well. What specifically? Now, Jesus is the only one who will have these in heaven. But the scars on his what? His hands, his side, and his feet. Reminder continually of what God has done for us. In heaven, don't worry. You'll be able to recognize your loved ones. And I cannot wait to be walking down those golden streets and see my brother Marvin there. Be able to come up and say, "Marvin, I'm so glad you're here. I'm so glad we're here." Amen. And I'll recognize him. He'll have a perfect knee then and a perfect body. But I'll still recognize him by his mannerisms. Someone else, you'll see them there. And you'll be so glad that they're in heaven with you. We'll recognize one another by our unique mannerisms, our voice intonations, and our individual personalities. You won't become a new person in heaven. You're going to be the person that God has made you into here on earth. Just so much better in a new body. And no more Satan to harass. Isaiah 33, verse 24. I love what the prophet Isaiah says here. Let's actually look in Isaiah. I want to go back to the word. Right there in the middle of your Bible, unless you have a big concordance at the end. But Isaiah chapter 33 and verse 24. You're there if you'd say amen. I hear some pages turning. We're almost there. Isaiah chapter 33 and verse 24. Amen. Notice what it says. And the inhabitants will not say what? Will we ever get sick in heaven? No way. Praise God. The people who dwell in it will be forgiven their what? Iniquity. If we're there, we're forgiven by the blood of Jesus Christ. Isaiah chapter 35. Just jump over two chapters to Isaiah 35. Notice verses 5 and 6. Isaiah describing some more dimensions of heaven. Then the eyes of the blind will be what? If you or someone you know struggles with eyesight, there will be no glasses in heaven. There will be no blindness in heaven because Jesus recreates the eyes. The ears of the deaf shall be unstopped. You struggle with hearing, God's going to recreate your ear, and you'll be able to hear perfectly everything that's said. The lame shall leap like a deer, and the tongue of the dumb shall sing. If you are lame, God's going to recreate you. There's a man that grew up in the church that I was born in. He's now an elder in that church, Three Angels Church of Wichita, Kansas. He was a good friend of our family. He had cerebral palsy. Loves Jesus with all his heart, is constantly witnessing for Jesus, is an incredible man of faith. I cannot wait until God raises Ray out of his wheelchair and he walks and runs. And as he told me, I'm going to fly. He can't wait. There's joy and happiness everywhere. It is a peaceful, incredible place to live. Revelation 21 and verse 4, right back there in that last second to the last chapter of Revelation. And God will what? Wipe away how many tears? Every tears or all tears from their eyes. There shall be no more what? Death. There shall be no more sorrow. There shall be no more crying. Why? There shall be no more pain, for the former things have what? Passed away. It's an interesting way to express this. Pain is now gone. Death is now gone. And the word passed away there is a similar word to dead. Death and pain is now dead. It will never come back. Praise God. Death, sorrow, crying, pain are gone forever. Can you imagine it? We will never go through those again. You will never have to wonder if there's only 5 years left on your life. Because we're going to live forever. Revelation 22, 1 and 2. And he showed me a pure river of water of life, clear as what? Proceeding from the throne of God and of the Lamb. And in the middle of its street, and on either side of the river, was the tree of life, which bore how many fruits? 12 fruits. Each tree yielding its fruit, how often? Every month. Now, it's very interesting. In Isaiah chapter 66, we're told that from one new moon to another and from one Sabbath to another, all flesh will come and worship before God. How often does the moon complete its cycle? Every what? Every month. It's interesting to me that every month the tree of life has a new what? So what does this mean? Every single month, all of us, whether we're traveling around the universe or not, will come back to heaven to celebrate the arrival of the new fruit on the tree of life. And only an infinite God can come up with all those different flavors and a tree that can have a different piece of fruit every single month. Each tree yielding its fruit every month. The leaves of the tree were for the what? Healings of the nations. We are now healed by the power of God. In heaven, we will be loved by God, cherished by God, embraced by God, and satisfied by God. Isaiah chapter 40 and verse 31, notice what the Bible says. But those who wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like who? Eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. They shall not hurt nor destroy in all my holy mountain. For the earth shall be full of the what? Knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. God's knowledge, God's love, God's strength, God's power, God's holiness will sweep across this planet. And every human being, from the smallest child until they've grown into adulthood, to the full-grown adult, and every person in between will love and know Jesus Christ. Heaven is a what? A real place. Christ says in Isaiah chapter 65 and verse 17, for behold, I create a new heaven and a new earth, and the former shall not be remembered nor come to mind. As you go down a million years, you know, at one point, maybe I'm walking down the street and I see my brother Alex Fitzpatrick there, and he and I are there, and as we're thinking about it, I'm like, you know, Alex, I think a million years ago we were, was it Lance? I don't remember where it was. It's so much better here, amen? We don't remember. It doesn't come to mind because everything is so much better. For behold, I create a new heaven and a new earth. In heaven, we're going to build houses. Now, Jesus builds us our mansion in the New Jerusalem. We're told Christ told the disciples to go to prepare a place for you. God is Jesus building us a mansion, but we build our country home. After the new earth is created, we get to create on the spot of land that God designates for us a brand new mansion. What does the Bible say? Isaiah chapter 65, verses 21 and 22. They shall build what? Houses and inhabit them. They shall plant vineyards and eat their fruit. They shall not build and another inhabit. They shall not plant and another eat. For as the days of the trees, so shall the days of my people. My elect shall long enjoy the work of their hands. Now think about this. If you're creating in heaven and you're going to plant a tree, you've got to think about where you want that tree in a billion years, if you're still going to be happy with it there because there's no more death. Are you with me? You've got so much more to think about. It's going to take a while, at least for me, to decide even where to start on building my house. There's so much more. We think temporarily here. There, you've got to think forever. What about fellowship and friends? And I say to you that many will come from the east and the west, of Christ speaking here in Matthew chapter 8 and verse 11, and will sit down with who? Abraham and Isaac and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. You're walking down the road there, and stream is flowing beside, and you're just taking in the scenery. And then you see the father of all of us, Adam, making his way down the same stream. And you're like, it's Adam. It's Adam. And you go up and you start talking to Adam. And Adam comes over to you and he begins to discuss with you the wonders of what's all around you. And as you guys are talking, you're like, Adam, what happened? Tell me the story. And in Eden, and Adam begins to tell the story, but then Adam says, no, I want to hear how God saved you. You're one of my children. Great, 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 great. I want to hear how God saved you. And you talk with Adam. Or maybe you're walking along and you see Moses. And Moses begins, he wants to know all the dimensions of what have happened in your life. And you want to know what it was like for Moses there on Mount Nebo when he finally laid down his life. And Moses tells you it was the hardest thing to not be able to go into the promised land. But I learned that God always has something better. He thought he was losing everything when he finally had to give his life up because of the sin he had committed. But then God comes, Jesus comes, and he resurrected Moses, and Moses spent the rest of the last 6,000 years in heaven. Praise God, 4,000 years. He tells us about it. You see Daniel, like, Daniel, were you afraid in the lion's den? And Daniel says, no, I trusted in God. It was a little cold. I sure looked hungry, but I knew God would carry me through. With the apostles, we hear from Peter, whose eyesight has been fixed as well, what it was like. We hear from Paul's eyesight has been fixed. We hear from Peter what it was like for Christ to forgive him and how he stood faithful all through the ages. And then one day, Jesus comes by your house. And he's standing at the entrance. I don't know how big our properties will be, but I'm guessing they'll be quite large. And he's like, do you mind if I could take a tour of life? Yes, I would love to have you here. And as you're walking along, Jesus begins to comment about the beauties of all around. And he's like, wow, you've done such an amazing job. You're like, Jesus, I can't do anything compared to you. But Christ is so humble. He lifts his creation up. Christ is going to lift you up. I don't want to miss heaven. How about you? And then we go to church. In heaven, we're going to go to church. Do you think if we're going to be going to church in heaven that we should miss church here on earth? Don't miss church. It's not the same unless you're here in the sanctuary worshiping together. Isaiah 66, verse 23, what does it say? And from one Sabbath to another, all flesh will what? Come to worship where? Before me, says the Lord. I can see that Sabbath morning. Take off from our property. We start flying towards the New Jerusalem. And as we're flying, we're seeing other people taking off, and they're joining the stream, and it's 100 people, then it's 1,000 people, and then there's millions of us, and it's just this huge cloud of people, and we're all flying towards the city, and we can't wait until we're there. And as we're going along, I'm looking over, and I'm talking to the person next to me. I'm like, did you hear? I hear that Jesus is preaching again this week. And you're like, yes, I know. I wonder what his topic's going to be. And we get there, and we get to heaven, and the angel choir is all set up. My wife is sure she's going to be singing it, so she's already there, prepared for it. And we're all gathered there, and the singing begins. And at first, everything gets really quiet. And then the conductor raises his hand, and it begins. And music like we've never heard wafts over heaven. Praise and adoration to the King of the universe. As the music wafts over us, our hearts are moved like they've not been moved before. It's a new song, a new composition about the love of Jesus. Perfect harmony. Perfect, perfect in every way. And then Jesus stands up. And he begins to open a new chapter of the scriptures we've never thought of before. And we walk away with a new comprehension of Jesus' love. Incredible Savior, precious friend, I don't want to miss heaven. How about you? As we come to the end, I want to end with one last verse. I'll ask my wife to step up to the piano. Go with me to Revelation chapter 2 and verse 4. For all the wonders of heaven, there's one that outshines every single other. Verses 3 and 4. If you're in your Bible, start in verse 3 with me. And there shall be no more what? But the throne of God and of the Lamb shall be in it. And his servants shall what? Now go with me to verse 4. They shall see his, and his name shall be on their foreheads. I want to see Jesus. More than all the other things, I want to look in the face of Jesus. I want to hear from his lips how he saved a broken up man named Phil. I want to know why he cared about me so much that he was willing to do all of that just to save me. You know, there's a lot of things on this planet that pull us away. Jobs that try to get us, that pressure feels more important than seeking after Jesus. There's friends. There might be family members that are trying to push us away from following Jesus or to take us away. Church, I appeal to you this morning. Don't let anything come between you and heaven. In all of the different controversies of life, this world is not our home. Just passing through. Keep your eyes fixed on Jesus and he will take us home. As we end, I know we weren't planning to do this, but I want to sing one verse of this hymn. Lindsay, what number is that? 633. Take your Bibles, or not your Bibles, your hymnals, if you would. Turn with me to hymn number 633. It's not on the screen, and that's okay. I want you to follow along. I ask you to stand as we sing together hymn number 633. Imagine what heaven is going to be like.
Sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing his mercy and his grace in the
Be there? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I've been reminded of the incredible place called heaven that you've laid aside for every one of us. We want to be there. We don't want to miss out on any of it. But Father, more than the grandeur of the New Jerusalem and the size and incredible wealth, beauty, more than the amazing new earth that you're going to create, more than the ability to travel to the different stars and visit planets throughout this universe, more than all of that, we want to see Jesus. He who our hearts have desired. Father, I pray for that man or woman, that boy or girl that's here. And in their mind, there's a question whether they're going to be there. They know they've had a broken week. They know they've fallen. Remind them that Jesus is big enough for whatever they've gone. Remind them of the power of Jesus to forgive and to restore. Remind them that this is a vision that you have for them. That through you, your love, your power, your saving grace, there is a home with their name on it. Send us forth from this place with your Holy Spirit. Guide us, we pray. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. I have just a couple of quick announcements for you before we are dismissed. First, I invite you to join us for our fellowship meal over in the gym. We'd love to have you. And I know that the Lord is going to bless through the food in a special way and the fellowship. It's important. Everyone listening, I know we're about to leave. It's important to fellowship together. Secondly, tonight, a very important topic. Don't miss tonight. I'm encouraging our guests to come, but membership, I'm encouraging you to come as well. It's one that I know will be an encouragement to you, to be one that I know you will appreciate, and I'm appealing to you to make it a point to find a way to be here tonight, so that you can hear our topic for this evening. If you've been here more than once, you're family now. We're glad you're here. God bless you. Happy Sabbath. We'll see you at the fellowship meal.